Hello, everybody, welcome to my channel. Today, I am going to explain and recap an epic TV series called The Wheel of Time. It's Amazon's big-budget show with each episode costing nearly $10 million. It is based on the 14-volume book series by author Robert Jordan, who published his first book in the year 1990. Although he passed away before completing this series in 2007, his friend and fellow fantasy author, Brandon Sanderson, completed it by referring to his notes. This is a mega book series, 80 of its books were on the New York Times bestsellers list. It won the Hugo Award and sold over 90 million copies. If you have not read it, then give it a shot, or else listen to it in audio form. This fictional world draws inspiration from early European and Asian mythologies, Hindu, Islamic and Buddhist traditions. Good versus evil, God versus evil, light versus dark. According to Buddhism, the Wheel of Time or Kalachakra holds the karmas or the actions of everyone, it decides when and how one experiences it. In this fictional world, at the dawn of time, a deity known as the Creator forged the universe and the Wheel of Time. The wheel spins the pattern of the ages using the lives of men and women as its threads. The wheel has seven spokes, each representing an age, and it is rotated by a magical force called the One Power, which flows from the true source. The One Power is divided into male and female halves, Sidin and Sidar, which work in opposition and in unison to drive the wheel. Humans who can channel this magical, One Power, are called Aes Sedai or simply channelers. At the same time, during creation, the Creator imprisoned an entity called the Dark One. The Dark One disagreed with the Creator on creation and wanted to spread his influence, which was malignant. The Dark One's true name is Shaitan, yep, a devil indeed. But people rarely speak it in fear that they will evoke his presence. He was referred to by other names like Father of Lies, Sightblinder, Soulsbane, and Lighteater. This entity is kind of similar to the Dark Lord in the Harry Potter series, where he had many names. Tom Riddle, the heir of Slytherin, he who must not be named, and Voldemort. According to books, the story goes like this. In the initial ages, both men and women used to channel the One Power energy. But during the Age of Legends, an Aes Sedai experiment called the Boar inadvertently breached the Dark One's prison, allowing his influence to seep back into the world. He rallied the powerful, the corrupt, and the ambitious to his cause, and these servants began an effort to free the Dark One fully from his prison, so he might remake time and reality in his own image. Like the Death Eaters of the Harry Potter universe. In response to this threat, the wheel spun out the dragon, a channeler of immense power, to be a champion for the light. In the Age of Legends, the dragon was a man named Lews Therin Telamon, who eventually rose to command the Aes Sedai and their allies in the struggle against the Dark One's forces. He defeated the Dark One in a 10-year-long war. However, at the moment of victory, the Dark One was able to corrupt his mind and his fellow men. All male Aes Sedai went insane. Lews Therin killed himself and his family. The other male channelers devastated the world with the One Power, creating genocide, hurricanes, earthquakes, and whatnot. Eventually, all female Aes Sedai killed all male Aes Sedai, leading only women to wield the One Power from that age. The women Aes Sedai managed and protected the mankind from that point to the next 3,500 years. In this new age, which is actually the third age, women enjoy full equality with men in most societies and are superior in some. Like Game of Thrones show, this series is also modified to meet the taste of the present-day audience. Meaning it will have more violence and adult content, which was not in the book. This show starts with the voiceover of Aes Sedai Moiraine Damodred, who narrates the prophecy of the dragon. According to this, dragon will be reincarnate in this age, who in his arrogance will try once again to close the prison of the Dark One, which will again make him mad and cause great destruction. According to the show, the dragon can be a male or a female. Moiraine and her warder Lan were on the move to find this new dragon and take him to the White Tower. The White Tower was the headquarter of all Aes Sedai, located in the Tar Valon city. It is the center of Aes Sedai power and is also the second largest, most populous city in the Westlands. The White Tower was adjacent to Dragonmount, where the first dragon channeled enormous One Power, which caused his death. In books, there are seven different types of Aes Sedai: blue, yellow, green, red, white, gray, and brown. We can see them in this clip. These ladies have a leader. Except Red Aes Sedai, all Aes Sedai have a warder, or you can say personal bodyguard. But it's not that simple. The bond between Aes Sedai and the warder is unique. They can feel each other feeling, they are bonded for life. And one more thing, all Aes Sedai wear a ring unique to their color, which helps them to channel One Power. In the beginning, we see two men running from red-clocked Aes Sedai. When they get caught, one of them says we can't die like this, we must use power. Aes Sedai says this power is meant only for women, and by touching it you made it filthy. Strangely, Aes Sedai was seeing only one man here, the other guy was visible only to the other man. Later, the Aes Sedai sisters use their powers, and we hear that man scream. Men are not able to wield the power of magic without the unfortunate side effect of going completely mad, so Aes Sedai used to hunt them down and gentle them by stripping them of their dangerous powers. Moiraine and Lan saw this, she says this is not the dragon. They continue their quest to a small hamlet of Emond's Field in the Two River District. Emond's Field was a small little hamlet where people lived happily. There lived five different potential dragon reborn candidates who are the main protagonists. Ran Althor, a young shepherd who lives with his father, Tam Althor. Perrin Aybara, a gentle giant of a blacksmith who lives with his wife Laila. Matt Cauthon, a good-for-nothing, unemployed guy who cares for his sisters. Egwene Alvear, a young woman and Rant's lover who has potential to become Wisdom, a female doctor of sorts. Nynaeve Almera, the current Wisdom of Emond's Field. We see Nynaeve, Egwene and other near a waterfall. Nynaeve welcomed Egwene in the women's circle. She was conducting a ritual of sorts. She asked Egwene to trust the water and threw her into the river. Egwene started flowing in the heavy current of water. Later at some distance she synchronized her mind and body with the flow. Some women incarnated with the strong potential of one power, this was the test of Egwene's ability. When she came back to the town in the evening, her parents and friends were extremely happy. Everyone drank and danced in the bar. The party was going well when suddenly Moiraine and Lan arrived. Everyone was shell-shocked and scared as Moiraine was like a battalion of the army. Whenever an army enters the town, even in a peaceful time, it's not a good sign. There was a war going on in the south from here, so everybody assumed that she was here for that. Moiraine asked for a room for the night, and the bar owner happily arranged it. While going, she took a great look at all five candidates. At late night Rand and Egwene hooked up directly, which was a deviation from the book. In the first book Rand was always trying hard to woo Egwene. Here Egwene reluctantly tells Rand the shocking thing, Nynaeve wanted her to be the next Wisdom, she had the potential. But the catch was, the life of Wisdom was a lonely one, a Wisdom can't marry or have kids. It's a service to people like nuns. Egwene has not decided yet, she was struggling with it. This obviously upsets Rand as he loved Egwene from childhood. Moiraine and Lan also took a hot bath. Here we see a hooded man also arriving in this town on his horse. Next day while on the petrol, Lan comes across several dead sheep, whose bodies were arranged in the shape of the number 6. Everyone in the village was preparing for the Feast of the Light Festival. It is a celebration so their loved ones' souls can make it back to them. It's a carnival of sorts. Here we see a merchant Payden Fane, arriving with his cart. Matt sells him a stolen bracelet for which he gets less money as Payden can't sell it here. This guy is an important one in later episodes. In the afternoon Rand tells sorry to Egwene for the last night and tells her to do what she likes with her life. He will be happy with her in anything she decides. Later Egwene and Nynaeve were on a bridge for a training session, apparently both can hear the sound of wind. Which to me seems as if they can hear every subtle sounds from a far distance. Today they heard many screaming voices which spooks them. In the evening people float lights in the river. After the ceremony, everyone was enjoying and dancing like a Norwegian folk dance. Suddenly, Trollocs attacked this hamlet. These were the foot soldiers in the Dark One's army, and they are looking for the same five candidates. These were a hybrid of an animal and a man. They walk upright and kill anything that moves. Trollocs started killing everyone in the village left, right, and center. Perrin and his wife Laila were in their house when some Trollocs attacked them. They fought with them ferociously, but Perrin accidentally killed Laila. She died on the spot. Rand and Tam were attacked at their house outside the village. Tam reveals that he has a very fancy sword, the kind used by knights, not farmers. They fight off their attackers, but Tam gets severely infected. Rand was surprised by this talent of Tam. At the village, a Trolloc picked Nynaeve and dragged her with him in front of Egwene. Finally, Moiraine and Lan jumped into the battle, and she started killing these Trollocs with her power. Soon she was overwhelmed as Trollocs kept coming at her. Finally, she channeled the one power to her potential and killed every Trolloc. Meanwhile, one Trolloc was able to get her, it injured her with a bow which started to slowly infect her. Next morning, Rand brings infected Tam to the village. Moiraine heals him with one power, as Trolloc poison can only be healed by one power. She can't heal her own wound, only another Aes Sedai can do it. Suddenly everyone saw another battalion of Trollocs approaching this village. Moiraine tells everyone about her visit, says one among the four is the dragon. Since Nynaeve was gone, only Matt, Rand, Perrin, and Egwene left. She asked them to travel to the White Tower with her, where her chief sister Aes Sedai will determine their fate. Reluctantly, suspiciously, Rand and his companions hoist themselves onto horses and started to ride out of Emond's field and the two rivers. These guys agreed, as they had no choice, Trollocs would have ripped and killed this town again to get them if they stayed. With this, the episode 1. Leave-taking ends. Overall, this is a great beginning. It has all the potential to become another master series. However, not all will be happy with it, as TV shows and movies based on a book seldom get it right. I will shortly recap episode 2 and 3. If you enjoyed this video, then please leave a like. Subscribe to the channel. Thanks for watching. Take care.